I want to introduce you to DxOs' powerful new Luminosity masking feature in this video. You'll find this in the recently released Film Pack 7, but you can also access the same tools when you have both DxO Film Pack 7 and Photolab 7 installed. I'm starting with a RAW file I shot with my Fuji X-T5. I haven't applied any adjustments to this image yet other than converting it to a DNG file using DxO's Pure RAW 3. When I open the file for editing, you can see that it's a bit overexposed. I shot this after sunset and I didn't adjust the camera's exposure compensation to darken the image. If we look at the histogram, we can see that the RAW file has captured the entire tonal range. Now before I go any further, I will apply the Fujifilm Provia standard digital film simulation. That's what I usually have my Fuji cameras set to shoot. I'll then go to the Customize tab where you'll find the new Luminosity masking tools. I'll also mention that there's been quite a change to the controls in Film Pack 7 over the previous versions. We now have much more control over things like colour and tone in the image. I want to use these controls to darken the image by reducing the exposure. Now if I scroll down, you can see the Luminosity mask section. I want to add the first Luminosity mask to select the sky in the image. I can add it by clicking the plus icon at the bottom of the list. You can then see the new Luminosity mask appear in the list. You'll also notice the controls in the Luminosity masking section become enabled. This includes a helpful mask range selector divided into 11 separate zones. This will immediately make sense to you if you're familiar with Ansel Adams' zone system. The darkest tones in the image are on the left and the lightest are on the right. Currently zone 5 is selected, but we can choose a different zone by clicking it with our mouse. As I do this, you can see the controls on the zone strip update to reflect the zone I click on. By doing this, we can see that the sky spans roughly zone 5 through to zone 9. I'll therefore click on zone 9 as a starting point. Then in the zone strip, I can click the control and move it to the left. As I do this, you can see the selected range increases, which is shown in the mask. The only problem now is that we have the foreground and sky selected. Applying any adjustment to the sky is also going to affect the foreground, which we don't want. To fix the problem, I'll select the erase brush in the bottom left corner of the interface. I can then change the size, feathering and opacity of the brush. I'll use a large brush and set the opacity to 100%. I can now paint over the areas that I don't want to select. As I paint, you can see that it removes the red mask from the area, telling me that it's no longer selected. When I only have the sky selected, I'll hide the mask using the Show Mask option. I can now apply an exposure adjustment using the controls in the light section of the Luminosity mask. As I use these, you can see that they now only affect the sky selected by the Luminosity mask. I'll also add a contrast and micro contrast adjustment to improve the definition of the clouds. If we want to see the effect of the adjustments, we can click the eye icon to the right of the Luminosity mask in the list. This hides the individual Luminosity mask, allowing us to see its effect. We also have an opacity slider if we think the adjustment is too strong. This means we don't need to change multiple sliders to reduce the strength of our effect. Now that I've adjusted the sky, the foreground looks dark and the heather is a bit dull. I'll therefore add a second Luminosity mask and use it to select the foreground heather. As before, I click the plus icon to add the new mask, which appears in the list. If I turn on the Show Mask options again, you can see the red mask selecting the image midtones. I can then click the zones to check the heather's luminosity range. Most of it is in zone 5 through to zone 7. I'll therefore click zone 7 to select it, and then move the luminosity range control down to zone 5. This selects the heather, but also the sky. So, I'll use the erase brush again to remove the mask from the sky. When that's done, I'll hide the mask again. I can then use the controls in the light section of the luminosity mask to make the heather appear brighter. Unfortunately, this does damage the colour in the heather. So to fix that, I'll increase the tint slider in the white balance controls to make the purple heather stand out more. We can then turn off the luminosity mask to check its effect. Working with a luminosity mask in this way feels effortless, and the results I've been able to produce seem quite impressive. If I need to, I can now continue to add more luminosity mask to adjust different areas of the image. When I'm done, I'll click the Apply button to close the luminosity mask tool. To finish the image, I'll scroll up to the top and just add a small vibrancy increase, and then scroll down to the bottom to use the global tone curve adjustment. When I use the compare icon at the top of the interface to compare the changes to the original image, you can see the difference the luminosity mask tools have made. As I said earlier in the video, if you have PhotoLab 7 installed as well as FilmPack 7, you can use the luminosity mask features in the local adjustments panel of PhotoLab. Watch my review video next to see PhotoLab's newly redesigned local adjustments. Thanks for watching today, and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please take a moment to share it with someone, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. I'll see you soon for another video.